You're about to listen to your daily word of God from our very man of God, Pastor Piotr Radley of Spring Chapel International Church, a church where people are led to a blooming relationship with God. Join us as we carry God's divine presence to the ends of the earth, as we make ready a people prepared for the Lord. God bless you as you listen.
Resurrection. What is the import of resurrection? Number one, resurrection happened to bridge a gap between the sinful man and the sinless God. He came to bridge the gap between a sinful man and a sinless God. What am I talking about? Man was full of sin. In the Old Testament, their sins could only be covered. Sins were only covered, and after a particular time, if they don't atone, atonement means covering. They do what is called atonement. And every year, the priest must come, enter into the Holy of Holies. Why? Because the temple in those days had three segments. We have the first segment, which is called the outer courts. The outer court is a place for everybody. Every Israeli can enter the place. Then we have the inner court. The inner court, or is called the holy place, is a place where the priests alone enter. All the priests have access into this place. And we have another place which is called the most holy place. Say it after me, say most holy place. Tell another member, say most holy place. Alright, the most holy place is a place where the high priest enters just once in a year, and he must enter there with the blood of calf or the blood of bulls. In other words, they will confess the blood of the whole nation upon the animal, and the animal is sincere. The animal did not commit sin. The animal did not do anything wrong. The animal now will carry the sin of the whole nation. Now, in other words, through sacrifice, there comes what is called exchange. The innocency of that animal will transfer to the human being, and the animal will carry the sin of the human. And as a result of that, so the blood of that animal is an innocent blood. That blood never sinned. So the high priest will carry this blood. And when the high priest is going, I wish they could give us the picture of the Levitical high priest. When he's going into the Holy of Holies, he must be sinless, or let me put it this way, he must be without sin. Because if he has any sin upon him, the high priest himself will first offer something for himself to purge his own sin. And he must enter now, is assumed to be without sin. Now what happens, if the high priest has any tone or dish of sin on him, when he gets or enters into the most holy place, he will die. And that's why when he's going, they always put something like a chain around his waist that should the high priest die in the presence of God. When they wait for him for hours and it does not show, they will use that thing to draw him up. And guess what? For that year is going to be a very serious year for all of Israel, because God will judge their sin. Hallelujah. Alright, so the high priest every year enters this place. There is the first court, there is the holy place, and there's what? The most holy place. Each of these segments had a curtain, or they call it a veil. Say it after me, say a veil. Now, something blocks the holy place from the most holy place, and something blocks the outer court from the holy place. So someone who is not a priest cannot just enter into the holy place. And someone who is not the high priest cannot just enter into the most holy place. But something happened the day Jesus was crucified. On the cross, after Jesus yielded the ghost, the Bible says darkness covered the whole face of the earth for 3 hours. And guess what? Something happened that never happened before. Before this time, no one had ever seen into the most holy place. No one has ever entered the place except the high priest. And he only enters the place just once in a year. For the first time, the veil that brought the partition, the veil that hindered penetration into the most holy place, that veil was cut from earth to bottom. And guess what? The high priest must have been in the holy place, and they were doing their own thing, laughing and gesticulating that Jesus, that fool, is dead. And guess what? They saw darkness upon the face of the earth. They thought maybe something is happening. But guess what? The Bible says there was a thunder that struck, And this thunder brought a partition. The first thing, they saw the outer court veil was open. The second court veil was open. And the veil that led into the most holy place, that same veil also was broken. And guess what? The high priest was shouting. And guess what was shouting in the temple? That guess what? The way into the holy place is open. The way into the holy place is open. The way into the holy place is open. Why? Because when Jesus died and when Jesus resurrected, because of his death and his resurrection, he brought us a free access into the presence of God. Look what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. It says, let us come boldly to the throne of grace and obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In other words, we all now have access to God. Because of this, no man needs a pastor to access God. And that's why, listen, Jesus came back and he said, go and tell my disciples and Peter that I go to my God and your God, to my Father and your Father. In other words, God will now come into a dimension as a result of knowledge because of what Jesus has made happen. We now see God and understand God as Abba. Say it after me, say it's Abba. The word Abba means daddy. In other words, it's not just a father, it's someone you have access to. Just like I have my kids, and guess what? No matter what I'm doing, my kids have access to me. Even I'm not going to see someone, I don't want to see anybody, I don't want to talk to anybody, but not my kids. Not my kids. If I'm praying in my prayer room and one of them is crying and crying and crying, I would be tempted to get up to go see what is happening. Why? There is something that turns me on when I hear them. And because of the asset that Jesus has created, every time a Christian understands this thing and uses and works in that understanding, you see something in God. There is something God cannot resist again. Because of this price. Because of the resurrection of Christ. God cannot put you off. God cannot say no to you. When you cry and you rev to God, when you talk to God, God hears you as a son. You now have a relationship of a father-son to him. And that's why the Bible says we can call him what? Abba, Father. Jesus says, I go to my God and your God. In other words, it's not just my God. It's now your what? Your God. I go to my Father. I call him Father. And guess what? He says, he is also your own Father. Say to your neighbor, say, he's my Father. Say it after me. Say, Father.
Father.
Do you pray to God like that? Some of you. In Jesus' name. You don't pray to Jesus. You pray to the Father in the name of Jesus. Father in the name of Jesus. That's the way to pray. For some of you, pray in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father. Some of you don't even pray to Father. In Jesus' name. Jesus, Son of God. Jesus, Elohim. Jesus, Holy Maker, Holy Michael, Holy Gabriel, Holy Blue. Holy Phantom. Holy Holy. And some will be calling the names of demons. Praise God. Tell your neighbor, say, I have access. Tell another neighbor, say, I have access. Or I tell someone, say, the veil has been broken. Say, I have access to God directly. So understand this, you too can pray and God can answer your prayer. Because the understanding some people have is, when I pray, God will not answer me. God does not like me. God will look at my prayers. God will not consider my own prayers. Not anymore. Matthew chapter 28, let's read from verse 51. The Bible says, and behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. You know, this was after Jesus cried. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, lifted up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the grave after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto men. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared God saying, greatly saying, truly this was the Son of God. Truly this was what? The Son of God. So the first thing about resurrection you must know is that resurrection cancels limitation. The power of resurrection cancels every form of limitation. It removes limitation from your life. It eradicates limitation. Let's get back to that scripture we read, verse 7. Matthew 27, 28, verse 7. Can we all really want to go? Verse 7. Matthew 28. I want us to speak something here. Want to go, everyone?
And
go
with me. And tell the disciples that I used to be from there. And behold, you are not coming into the land. Then shall you see the Lord.
The angel said, and go quickly. Tell your neighbor, say go. Tell another member, say go. Why would the angel say go? Why? Because Jesus has created the access. The limitation has been broken. So the angel gave an instructional word and said, go. Tell your neighbor, say go. Can I say this to you? Listen. The only place you cannot go in the whole of this world and this earth is where you feel not to go. As far as God is concerned, there is no limitation strong enough to stop him from going anywhere. If you want to go into the presidency, you have a right. The Bible says the promises of God in him are yea and amen. God says to you, son, you say, Lord, I want to enter into the presidency. God says what? Go. I want to go to Europe. God says what? Go. Listen, when you understand the power that works with resurrection, there is no limitation that can limit you. There is nothing that can stop your access to any place. Why? Jesus did not just give an access in the realm of the spirit. He gave us a physical access. We have access. And that was why you notice this after Jesus, before Jesus was buried, it was a poor man that carried his cross. When Jesus died on the cross, it was a rich man that came for him. John of Arimathea. Why? The grace of Jesus, the great Jesus brought forth as a result of his death. Now, is to give everyone access. You have access to the top. I told them before service, listen, Jesus was ministering one time. I wanted to feed some numbers of people. The Bible says there was a young boy who had 5 bread and 2 fish. 5 loaves and 2 fishes, the Bible says. And listen, so many times I told them, many people think Christianity, Jesus came to preach and to minister to the poor, to make the poor rich. It's all about the poor being rich, the poor getting rich. And guess what? There are some who don't have any business with poverty. They are rich already. But see, people don't know that the gospel is not just for the poor. The gospel is also for the rich. Now listen, the boy, the mother gave him a lunch. People saw a lunch, but Jesus saw an opportunity in it. All that they thought that thing for the boy was worth. And guess what? Any parent that would give a small boy a lad, the Bible says, that would give a lad 5 loaves of bread. 1 bread, 2 bread, 3, 4, 5. The guy has 5. And fish. 2 fishes. I told them, not the one they've caught. You know why? That's where they fed us. I don't understand. My mom, at times, when she wants to deal with you, you think she's happy with you, she will give you the head. It was when I go to an instant, I found that the head of the fish is punishment. I don't eat it. Up to now, you don't serve me food and serve me head. It's an abuse to my position in destiny. I'm too glorified to hate that one. It's blooming. You just enjoy, just a feel of fish. And some of you will be breaking the heart of the fish. Punishment. Do you know there are people, they don't put such inside their food? Inside their stew, they cut it over and dash it out. I'm not saying you should stand up. Understand my message. This boy had 2 fishes. A old fish. Not part of a fish, old fish. So in essence, you must understand that the parent of this boy must have been very rich people. And guess what? I told them this. The Holy Spirit taught me this. The gospel is not just meant for the poor to be rich. It's also meant for the rich to be richer. Jesus came for every class of man. Every class of man. Hallelujah. Praise God. Tell your neighbor, say no restriction again. Say no, nothing can stop me from moving forward. Did you hear what I said to you? Anywhere you want to enter, what do you do? Enter. Pastor, I want to go to US. If your reason want to go to Europe. I just like Europe. If your reason is genuine, what do you do? Enter. Tell your neighbor, say enter. Tell another neighbor, say enter. Tell someone, say the siege is broken. Nothing can limit us again. In the name of Jesus. There's something special and fantastic I want to bring up. Matthew chapter 28 from verse 1. Come on, are you still in this place? Ladies, are you in the house? I want to talk to you. I want to show you something about you that you've not seen. Are you ready for this? I like ladies. Sometimes they are very sharp. For many times. Alright, the Bible says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to the sepulchre. I want to start my message from here.
Hallelujah.
Who came to see Jesus? Mary. Say Mary.
Mary.
How did Jesus start his ministry? With whom did Jesus start his ministry? Jesus started with men. When Jesus started his ministry, the Bible says Andrew followed him. Andrew brought Simon Peter. And Jesus gave a prophecy about Nathanael. And Nathanael said, oh, behold, he said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? And he was saying, do you know me? How come Jesus spoke about him and said, before you spoke to Philip under the fig tree, he said, I saw you. And he was wondering, how did you see me? And Jesus started his ministry with a crowd of males. Say it after me, say males. But do you notice this? After resurrection, Jesus didn't start with males, he started with females. Jesus started with who? Females. Who was sent to go and tell the disciples? Women. You know, was the resurrection of Jesus canceled gender inequality. You know, there are times people say, you know something, because I'm a woman, and this, the reason I can't become a president is because I'm a woman. That thing was canceled by the resurrection of Jesus. And listen, we've seen men of God. This is the season to see women of God. We have so many men of God and we still have things like this. Why? Because the world has not experienced another dimension of God. I love what the Bible says. It says, now there is neither male nor female, for we are all one in Christ. He says, if we are the one, if we are all Christ, then are we Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise? Tell your neighbor, if you have any female closest to you, tell them, say, arise. Tell her, say, arise. Say, God is depending on you. Tell someone who is a female, say, you too can become a president. Say it to yourself, you're a female, I can be president.
I can be president.
Leave that mentality, I will be a president's wife. Oh Lord, let me be a governor's wife. You too can become one, a president. Jesus started with names. And guess what? Jesus started the real thing. Because the real thing is after resurrection. With you, females. Listen, don't have the mentality that the Bible said women are the weaker vessels. Listen, if you study your Bible well, in the agenda of God, we have men, women, and children. Men, women, and children. Listen, when the Bible calls the woman a weaker vessel, it was not trying to express faith. Because many people have the mentality that there are things I can do because I'm a woman. No. There is so much you can do. God sees you and holds you responsible for things. He depends on you for things. Now listen, when the Bible says, listen, do you understand? We all know English. We have weak, weaker, and what? Say it again. Alright, let's arrange it. Man, woman, and children. So what's man? What's woman? What's children? So that's what the Bible was saying. So who's a woman? Woman does what? So listen, every time you say, you know what? And you know, I'm a woman. Remember that man himself is what? Weak. Tell your neighbor, say, there is nothing I can imagine.
There is nothing I cannot.
There is no position I cannot climb.
There is no position I cannot.
Now, I want to understand this. Listen, this is the generation where God is going to raise women like Peter Cunningham. A single woman should the whole of humans. shook the whole world in that time. A woman. When you see a triple man, it's like you see Jesus. Gates of Maria would hurt her. A woman that had a job passed on the church, and guess what? Government said, you know, your church want to construct a road, and you have to break a portion of your church because the road must pass the place. And they were telling her, you know what, we have to bring down the church. And she stood, a woman. Say to your neighbor, say woman. And guess what? In the middle of the night, she said, you know what, we won't break down a church. We only get the church out of the road. And guess what? She prayed. Went to some people around her to come and see. Listen, God doesn't do great things in the hurry. He likes to make a public show of things. And those people surrounded the church. And she began to speak in tongues. And she pushed the church. She pushed the building outside of the road. A woman. That's why I tell you, listen. There are females and there are females. Yes, that's the truth. Some females are not just, they lie on the bed. And that's why you must understand, don't let the devil shit your destiny. You are not a baby maker alone. You are not a bed liar alone. You are not a rapper. You are not created to fulfill the primal hurts of a man. You have a destiny to fulfill. Say to your neighbor, say, I have a destiny to fulfill. You know, sometimes when ladies go to an exam, the next thing they are thinking is marriage. Can I say something to you? This is not a marriage seminar. But here's the truth. When we cooperate with divine assignment, destiny fulfills itself naturally. When a person cooperates with divine assignment, destiny fulfills itself naturally. I tell people, I never prayed for a wife. I didn't pray or ask God for a wife. God supplied, when God saw that I was cooperating and doing, handling destiny the right way, He supplied the woman. But what is your prayer? There are some ladies, the only prayer point in their life is, God, give me a man, give me a husband. Resurrection canceled that agenda. The greatest thing about your life is not marriage. You do have a destiny to fulfill. And the earlier you start realizing that, the better it is for you. I hate a woman that is not going anywhere. God is looking for a guy to stay under. He said, let me just marry a rich man so that I will better my lot. Why? You are poor. You thought God created you to be poor. So you are looking for someone to so please. Ah, I will so please you. Ah, don't worry. Just marry me. Man, when you see a baby talk like that, just say accidents. Accidents, it won't happen. That's an accident looking for somewhere to happen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Listen, no limitation is as great as the one you put on yourself. No limitation is as great as the one you put on yourself. Many females have that thing. Many are not aspiring for anything great. Why? There is a limitation parents have put into them. That you know what, you are a female. You know what, you are a girl. Stop pretending that you are a girl. Stop telling children they are girls. You are human. Attempt it. Do it. When you see a female saying, I want to do it, I say, no, it's for males. Who told you? Who told you? Gender inequality was cancelled through resurrection. And guess what? Every female man can become anything. Hallelujah. You know one thing I love about good word Etta? You know, Mark Fassin of Foursquare, the woman who started Foursquare Gospel Church. You know, in her day, when she's holding crusade, she will sit down, wheelchairs, everyone will gather, and she will just enter into their midst. Stand up. That's the way she ministers. Simple McPherson. Stand up. And she's stretching her hand. They are getting up. But today, the ladies of today, the lady is just 16. She's already thinking marriage. Who will marry me? Yet there are nations to take. God loves you, but we are thinking nations. We are thinking nations. Tell your neighbor, say, start thinking nations. Stop thinking of one small home, one small kitchen, one bedroom, one parlor, one. Stop thinking that way. Think of nations. The lesser things of life are included in the greater. When you go for the great things of life, the lesser things will serve and come to you naturally. The greatest sign you are failing is if you attempt in life as small things. I said this to us a long time. When you attempt great things, you stretch. When you attempt small things, you shrink. Listen, when you understand what Jesus has done through his resurrection, you start attempting anything. You start attempting anything. Say it to your neighbor, say, attempt anything. You know, one time I read about Susanna Wesley. That's the mother of Charles Wesley and the brother, John Wesley. The woman had 1 and 9 children. How many is that? Talk to me, how many? 19 children. She had 19 children. How many children? And guess what? She would pray, speak in tongues at least 1 hour every day. Charles Wesley composed 500 hymns that are still standing till today. He sang the hymn, he sang the song on his birthday. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. It was on his birthday, he sang it. And those hymns are still standing. Wesley started Methodist Church. It's still standing today. Like they were brought up by a woman who stood with them and paid the price. All of our children sister, all of the 19 did well. Listen, there are mothers and there are mothers. But guess what? In this church, in our ministry, we are raising superhumans. Super mothers. In other words, listen, some of you can have up to 7 children. If that's your choice, you can have 19. And all 19 will do well. All 19. I read about Donald Trump. Listen, they told the story about him that none of his children come by me. Very rich. They said none of Donald Trump's children asked that on their body. So understand this. It is not a question of, you know, there are so many in our family. That's the reason we all are like this. We are supermoms. And this is the generation of supermoms. Neighbor, say, if you're hearing me, say, I'm a supermom.
I'm a supermom.
But most of you are not even like you are. Say, I'm a supermom.
I'm a supermom.
Some are talking like, when you go, I'm supermom. Talking like someone that is advertising them. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And they are super dads.
Super.
I love them. Say, I'm a super dad.
I'm a super dad.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Alright, let's go with that story. The Bible says Mary came to the sepulcher to come complete the endowment of Jesus. And she looked into the cave, she couldn't find Jesus. The Bible says she turned around. You know, she was bereaved. And listen, Mary was so bereaved. She was desperately bereaved that she couldn't recognize Jesus. Jesus was there. And she thought Jesus was one of the soldiers, one of the keepers, because there were soldiers there. And she asked Jesus, where have you kept my Lord? Where have you kept him? And I love what Jesus did. You know, I prayed that prayer this morning. And I love what Jesus said. You know what Jesus said to her? Jesus said, Mary. And she recognized the voice. Rabboni, she shouted. She wanted to touch him. Jesus said, no, don't touch me. He said, I've not ascended to my Father. Go and tell my disciples and Peter that they should meet me in Galilee. I love something. The Holy Spirit began to use that to minister to me. Listen, the woman was bewitched. She was confused. And guess what? Jesus remembered her and called her name. And I began to say to God, Lord, anytime I'm stranded, anytime I lose hope, anytime I don't know what to do again, call my name. Call my name. Listen, Jesus didn't say, I'm Jesus. He just called her name and she was ministered to. She knew what to do. Say it to your neighbor. Say, look up to heaven and say, Lord, call my name. Imagine you're dreaming or something is happening in your life and God just, all God has to do for you, if he just says Toby, Toby, you hear the word of the Lord, Toby. You know, there was one guy, I think he's no more around, he came from before the movement. He was so excited. So excited. He said, Pastor, you need to hear this. Pastor, you need to hear this. I said, tell me something. He said, he came after I had a meeting with the leaders yesterday and said, during Good Friday miracle night, he said, Pastor, you mentioned my name. You mentioned my family's case. I said, okay, so what might happen? He said, Pastor, you didn't get it. Let's see what has happened. He mentioned my name. I said, okay. You mentioned my daddy's case. What you said in Lord, I said, Lord, you mentioned, Pastor, you gave a professor. He was in my office for 30 minutes. He was just saying the same, you mentioned my, you said to him. He said, okay, what happened? What happened? That's my own anxiety. Let's leave this one. He said, Pastor, don't just leave it. My father is a soldier. He said, Pastor, you mentioned my dad's case. He's a soldier, you can do that. You mentioned his case. I was tired. So when I read my scripture and I saw Jesus coming in, I remember to know. And I turned to God, I said, Lord, anytime I'm hopeless, call my name. Call my name. Anytime I'm about giving up, call my name. Elijah found himself in a position, a place he was giving up. And all God did for him, God just called his name, Elijah. What means that? And guess what? That was it for Elijah. Paul found himself in the cell in Acts chapter 27. They were being taken to Rome and there was tempest on the sea. And guess what? It was like everybody was going to lose everything and everybody would die. But guess what? He said, there stood by me this night the angel of the Lord whom I serve and whose I am. And you know what all the angel did? The angel just called him Paul. He called his name Paul. Listen, when God calls your name, every other thing will naturally follow. Acts chapter 9, Jesus called his name, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou? It was just a question. And his head became correct. Shout it out loud to God. Say, Lord, call my name.
Lord, call my name.
Tell another neighbor, say, Lord will call your name.
Lord.
Say, God will mention your name.
I will mention your name.
In the name of Jesus. You know why I'm so excited about that guy? Even though he called him and the dad said that the money that we wouldn't believe that God just supplied for them yesterday. God gave them the amount that was necessary to buy a car. God blessed the dad yesterday. A contract came true. The dad is a soldier. A contract came true. But the guy was so, I love his faith. His faith was not that the money had come. His faith was this. God mentioned my name. God mentioned, Pastor, you mentioned my name. You mentioned my case. That was enough for joy for him before you will even hear the testimony. May God call your name.
Amen.
Tell another member, say God will call your name. The second thing I want us to see about from this story, this account of resurrection, John chapter 19, verse 27, of what resurrection does and what resurrection will do. John 19:27. The Bible says, then said he to the disciple, behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. Who was this disciple Jesus was talking to? John. The Bible says Jesus stood on the cross and said, "Son, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son." Now listen, Jesus was the first son of his mother. He was not the only child. You know that? He was not the only child. Jesus had other siblings. And yet, Jesus did not commit his brother into the hand of his siblings. He committed his mother into the hand of someone he was not even related to. Why? Listen, John was a man that loved Jesus sincerely and passionately. And the Holy Ghost began to make that minister to me. Listen, when you approach and understand the power of resurrection, your real family members are not your siblings. Many times, God will settle you through strangers. God will use people you don't know, people you are not even connected to help you and to lift you. There are times the help you need may not even come from your siblings. But guess what? When you come into the power, the state, the understand resurrection, God brings you into a larger family. And guess what? All of us are associated, not by blood, but by spirits. What connects us? You know, people say blood is thicker than water. But guess what? There is something thicker than blood, and that is spirits. There is a spiritual union. And that's why, listen, that's why we all, in those days, the Bible says all the apostles we gather. As their manner was every day, they would gather to share blood and to eat the flesh. Why? There is something they are not sharing that is stronger than blood. Jesus gave his mother over to John. And the Bible says he took his mother into his own home. All the other siblings, he didn't commit his mother to them. I came to pray for someone, everybody in this mess. God will send you strangers that will help you.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? God will send you people you don't know, people that are related to you. Listen, this is how resurrection power works.
It's not necessarily someone you are connected to or someone that loves you,
because your real family members are those who stay with you through the thick and thin. Study your Bible. When Jesus was being crucified, none of his family, his brothers, were there. They didn't stay. It was only his mother that was there, disciples. And other people were there to mock him. Strangers will work for you.
Amen.
You didn't know what I'm saying? I said, people you don't know from anywhere, they will stand with you and stand for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let me bring forth one lesson from this picture only. I'll be ready to pray. What's that thing the Spirit of God is ministering to us? Through the resurrection of Jesus as he went to the tree. What was that thing? You know, I was trying to explain that thing during the second service. And one big picture I want us to have about the resurrection of Jesus. Number one. If I'm able to give us two or three, and if it is just one, I think I've done a good job. Number one, no matter what you have, or no matter who you are, you can't stop prophecy. You can't what? Stop prophecy. Listen, the man to fear the most is not a man that can kill, or the man that has some connections, or the man that has the money to do things. The man to respect and fear the most in this world is any man that is carrying prophecy. Listen, the hope you have with heaven is the prophecy over your life. Many people are struggling and just, many people waste their time in prayer because they don't know how to handle this thing. Many are praying things they don't know anything about. Look at Jesus. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 28, the angel said, "He has risen as he said. He prophesied, I know I will die. The third day, I'm going to rise." A prophecy went ahead. When Jesus was born and was doing ministry, he said, "In the volume of the book it is written of me, I come to do thy will, O God." Say it after me, say prophecy. No, you're not saying that out loud. Say prophecy.
Prophecy.
Now listen, understand this. For every one child of God, you carry prophecy. Every child of God is has a prophetic agenda under God. And listen, the aberration to life and destiny is for you not to understand your prophecy. What has God said concerning me? Jesus understood the boldness and confidence Jesus had to face death was what God has said. You are going to the grave and you will come back. And guess what? He could face the devil. He could face the pain. He could face the trouble. Why? Because of prophecy. Because of prophecy. Listen, your hope is your prophecy. Your hope in life is your prophecy. And listen, when you come to the place in your life, you know, you understand the prophecies around you. You know, there are things you face, it doesn't shake you. There are things you go through, it doesn't move you. You know why? Because you know prophecy, something has been spoken. God has said something. And listen, the question I wish you should ask yourself this morning is this: what has God said concerning you? What has God said? What is the prophecy over your life? Because we saw Jesus moved and operated under a strong atmosphere of prophecy. Ask your neighbor, is there any prophecy over you? 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 18. 1 Timothy, see, your prophecy is the platform for your success in life. No prophecy, no success. Prophecy, no what? No success. This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy. Now notice this. See what Paul was writing to him. He says, now according to the prophecies which went before on thee. What are the words that have been spoken that have gone ahead of you? What has been said? What has been spoken over your life? He says, according to the prophecies which went before thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare. In other words, you stand for your prophecy. You pray for your prophecy. Many people are praying about things that they have no prophecy about. Listen, it makes prayer become a waste of time. Every child of God, for your life, you must understand this is what God has said. And guess what? You begin to arrange prophecy. You start standing and praying prophecy. Why? So that you will bet the reality of it. You know, Timothy says, well, you want a good warfare by the prophecies that have gone ahead of you. What has been spoken over you? The worst and the most empty life on earth is a life that is carrying no prophecy. Hallelujah. Listen, what is the prophecy for your life? The prophecy over Jesus' life was, I will die and I will resurrect. That was his prophecy. And guess what? As a result and because of that, Jesus fulfilled it. It came to pass. Listen, do you know that every time you pray, it is only those things God has spoken over you that has the right to come to pass? That's why I told us some time back, never start a journey without a prophetic word. What is God saying? This is 2018. What has God said? The Bible says God spoke in Hebrews chapter 13. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So that we may boldly say. So that we may boldly say. He has said. And guess what? We say what he has said. Jesus stood one time, he said, destroy this temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. He began to use every acronym to display and to talk prophecy. He was confident and bold. The operation of the power of resurrection works upon your prophecies. It works upon your prophecies. You're saying, well, I want to get married. What has God said? Because listen, heaven and earth may pass away, but not one jot of his word will go without being fulfilled. Hallelujah. Praise God. Tell your neighbor, say, I can't carry prophecy.
I carry prophecy.
Say to another neighbor, say, I carry prophecy.
I carry.
Let me say something, I'll be ready to pray. Maybe I'll just see this one. And the rest, I commit one to God, one to Jesus, and the last one to the Holy Ghost. British. Say amen. Right. If you look at the tomb of Jesus, I did a little study about the tomb of Jesus. The tomb where Jesus was placed, the cave, it was a cave inside a rock on a hill. Now follow this. The cave was on top of a hill. It is a place you climb to. If you have ever seen any picture of the tomb of Jesus, it was not on the ground, it was on top of a hill. And secondly, in other words, if anybody is trying to steal the body of Jesus, anybody can see that person from any angle. Number two, when Jesus was placed in the tomb, the Bible says they brought a great stone, say it after me, great stone, to block the entrance of the tomb. Mighty stone. Number three thing they did to the tomb of Jesus, the stone was sealed. It was concreted to the cave. So there is no way you can naturally push it up or take it out. And on the fourth thing they did, they placed soldiers around the place to keep the watch of the place. Why did they do four things? To make sure the prophecy of coming back to life after 30 days was not going to pass. Their attempt was to frustrate prophecy. But guess what? In spite of the four barricades, it still happened. In spite of the fact that soldiers were there, even watch day and night, guess what? It will not happen. If God has said it, nothing can stop it. If God has said it, nothing can stop it. Say it to your neighbor, say nothing can stop it. Tell another neighbor, say nothing can stop it. You know, I was meditating and I asked, I began to look. When the Bible says, Matthew 28, verse 1 into 2, the Bible says, an angel came and rolled away the stone. Came with lightnings in his face. And I love what the angel did. The angel rolled it away and sat upon it. I was wondering, what were the soldiers doing? What were the soldiers saying? And guess what? You know, the second thing. Jesus, I was asking the Lord, why? Did you notice this? Jesus came out of the clothes with which they wrapped him. He didn't come out with the same clothes that he was buried with. Study your Bible. The Bible says he folded those clothes. He came out, so it was a supernatural thing. The resurrection of Jesus was vitally and totally supernatural. He came out of that clothes. And guess what? Another clothes clothed him. And not only that, Jesus could have walked out supernaturally out of the stone, and the stone would not stop him. But I said, Lord, listen, I was asking the Lord, why did you have to take away the stone? You should have left them to have that display. No, he's not the one. He's not the one. God said something to me. He said, son, listen, anytime I want to do something, I love to announce it. God wants to announce it. That was why when you had a small problem, it was people that you had something, you prayed and prayed and prayed, God was looking. Why? He wants to do something with you. He wants to do something that people say, eh? What are you talking about? You mean you? You thought if you are here, we thought your life was gone, we thought your life was spent, we thought that was the end about you. You say, well, see what the Lord has done. Tell your neighbor, say nothing can stop my prophecy. How many people in this place you have prophecy over you? You carry prophecy. Is there anybody here that is no prophecy? I have prophecy for you. Even if no one has prophesied over you, I came with the word of the Lord to speak a word over you this morning. tell your neighbor, say, I have prophecy. Say, my prophecy is the platform for my success. This is when you carry that prophecy, what a good warfare with it. Because no matter what hell does, no matter what the devil does, no matter what people do against it, you cannot be frustrated. Stand on your feet. Hallelujah. Where is your banner?